In this tutorial, we will work on a common ETL scenario. We have multiple CSV reports that we downloaded from the World Bank. These files trace the dynamics of electricity production from fossil fuels, renewable sources, nuclear power, and hydroelectric power on a global scale. All these files have the same structure, so let's take a closer look at one of them. This is an excerpt of the file that shows the percentage of electricity production from fossil fuels in different countries from 1960 until 2015. The headers describe various attributes of this data, a country's name and code, the name of an indicator, as well as its code. After that, each column shows a year, which indicates that this report represents historical data over time. Also, we can see that in some year fields, there is no data available. A very interesting feature of this CSV report is that it has a wide format. Each year is a separate column, and with data spanning over 60 years, the file becomes really wide. On the one hand, this format can be cumbersome. So statistical software and machine learning algorithms often expect data in a long format, with longer data in fewer columns. On the other hand, the wide format we see in this file allows avoiding redundant data. So extracting this data from the year field seems to be a daunting task, but MapForce will tackle this case quite easily. Our main goal is to present our data in a long format and create a separate record in the database for each country and year. And this is how we're going to proceed. First, we want to extract all the data from all the sources, then filter this data and round up percentage values, and then load the transformed data into the database. At this stage, our goal is to read data from multiple CSV files from the same folder. Besides, we'll also be able to see preliminary results in the SQL script in the output pane. Let's add a text component to the mapping. MapForce prompts us to select a method of processing text files. The first option enables you to deal with complex nested structures. And the second option allows processing standard CSV files as well as fixed-length files. We will select the second option. Let's first test only one file for simplicity. As soon as we load the input file, its structure and contents appear at the bottom of the dialog. By default, the checkbox "Treat empty fields as absent" is enabled. This means that empty fields will not be mapped. We also need to enable the first checkbox. This option will treat the first row as field names. Let's also give the component the following name. Before being able to transform the data and preview the output, we will need a target. Our target is an SQLite database that has two tables. The first table will handle values mapped from the CSV files. This table has a composite primary key that consists of three fields. This ensures the uniqueness of each row of data. And the second table will receive tracking information about when the mapping was last executed. This information will be inserted through a custom SQL statement in the last part of our ETL tutorial. Now let's add the target database to the mapping. We need only the first table, and we will deal with the second one a bit later. The next step is to connect the source and target. But now we have an issue: how to get each year and its value. Having a separate year column in the database corresponding to each year field in the source file would be absolutely counterproductive. Instead, we will use a really cool feature that is called dynamic node names. Let's right-click the rows node and then select Show child elements with dynamic names. We will use the default settings. You can now see the changes in the source component. One of the main advantages of this feature is that it enables you to access not only node values, but also node names, and supply these node names as values. The role of the element node is to supply the sequence of all cells of each row from the CSV file. The node name and text node supply the name and value of each item in the sequence, respectively. So to get the name of each year header, we will map the node name to the year column. And to extract the contents associated with a particular year header, we will map the text node to the value column. Now let's take a look at the parent connection. According to the main mapping rule, for each source item, one item is created in the target. In our example, this principle has the following meaning. For each row of CSV data, one row of data will be created in the records table. Mapping this row to the database will produce the following result. As for the country and indicator codes, they are supplied from the source nodes directly, but the year and the percentage value associated with it are supplied dynamically. So MapForce loops through all the column headers and outputs each value to the same field, overwriting the previous value. The same happens to each value of the row. In the end, we have the name of the last available column header and the value tied to it, and this is not our goal. Instead, we want to get one row in the database for each year and country, which is possible thanks to the element node. That's why we need to tweak the top connection. Mapping the element node to the records table leads to the following results. A new record is created for each cell of each row of our CSV file. But now I have another issue. How will MapForce know which nodes represent years and which don't? In this case, we need a filter on the parent connection. We also need the numeric function. The values will come from the node name node. And the result will be connected to the Boolean condition of the filter. This function returns true if the input value is a number or a string that can be passed as a number. In our case, it's a perfect solution because only year fields will be passed as numbers and the others will be considered strings. Let's take a look at the output. We already have very consistent results. Each row of data will have information about a particular country, year, indicator code, and also the share of electricity production from fossil fuels. As for the country and indicator codes, you can always look them up in the metadata files shipped together with the CSV report. At this stage, we only preview these SQL statements, but no data is written to the target. This way, we can test everything safely. We will load the data into the database at the final stage. Since all our reports have exactly the same structure and are located in the same folder, we can tweak our source component so that it reads data from all the CSV reports. And let's also check the output to see whether everything works all right. Based on the indicator codes, our source component has successfully read data from all the CSV reports. At this stage, we will filter the data to display values only from a particular year range, and we will also round up percentage values to make them more user-friendly. The output contains a large amount of data. Now let's assume we want results only from 2000 until 2015. For this purpose, we'll set another filter on the parent connection. And then we'll need three functions that will help us get a range. The first one is called equal or greater. The second one is equal or less. And the last one is logical AND. For the first two functions, the A parameters will receive data from the node name node. For the B parameters, we will create constants. Then we'll supply the results of these two functions to the logical AND function. And we will map the result of the logical AND function to the Boolean parameter of the filter. The filter will evaluate all the year fields and output only those values that correspond to this year range. Let's take a quick look at the output. All the values for this year range are here, and the others are excluded. The only issue we still have is that all percentage values are pretty big and clunky, so let's go back and fix this. We need the round precision function. Next, we need to move the connection from the text node to the value of the function. As for the second parameter, we will supply 1 as a constant value. This value shows the number of decimals to which percentage values will be rounded up. Finally, let's connect the result of the function to the value column. Let's check the output. The percentage values are now much easier to read. To improve the readability of our mapping, we will also provide a comment describing what kind of data we deal with. Before loading all the data into the database, we will configure transactions and database table actions. You can define transaction handling at various levels. In our example, we will enable transactions at database component level. If you select this option, all database changes will be enclosed in a single transaction. The single transaction will be rolled back in case of a database-related error, and processing will stop. A single transaction also allows speeding up processing. To configure table actions, we need to click the Table Actions button of the database component. In the top part of the dialog, we will define two statements that will be executed before the first record is processed. The first statement inserts the date of mapping execution into the tracking info table, and the second statement deletes everything from the records table. After that, all the source data will be inserted into the records table. To find out more about database table actions, please watch our video linked in the description below. The design of our ETL mapping is now complete. The biggest advantage of our design is that it's really powerful and flexible. If you have some new CSV reports in the same location, the mapping will also take them into account. And if, for example, you have more year fields, you can quickly add them right in the CSV component. Let's take a final look at the output. We are now ready to load the data into the database. The processing of the statements has been extremely fast. Now let's check the actual data in the database. All the records seem to be alright. We can also check when the mapping was last executed. You can test all these features yourself. Simply download the fully featured 30-day free trial from the Altova website.